considering the transcription of eukaryotic genes. And as you know, the transcription of eukaryotic genes, we have DNA here, and we transcribe that DNA into RNA. In eukaryotes, of course, this all occurs in the nucleus. And in the cytoplasm of the cell, there are the protein manufacturing macromolecular assemblages, ribosomes, which have small and large subunits. And it is upon the ribosomes that the RNA needs to be translated into protein. So the RNA in eukaryotes is exported out of the nucleus, this is the nucleus here, into the cytoplasm. And there it engages ribosomes, and the ribosomes translate the messenger RNA into protein. So prior to this export into the cytoplasm, however, eukaryotic RNAs are modified in several ways. They are processed in several ways, and it's that which we're going to consider now. And the first type of RNA processing in eukaryotes is that upon transcription of a messenger RNA from a eukaryotic gene, this is DNA, double-stranded DNA, and here is what we would call a pre-mRNA, also known as heterogeneous nuclear RNA, for historical reasons that we don't need to consider. The first step that is going to occur in processing, and when I say first, I don't necessarily mean a temporal order. I simply mean these occur, but can occur simultaneously or in sequence, but not no defined order. The first thing is that there is a 5' cap that is added to the 5' end of the messenger of the pre-messenger RNA, and that 5' cap consists of a 7-methyl guanosine triphosphate, and we'll look at the addition of that shortly. So 5' cap is added, and unlike the prokaryotic messenger RNA, which has a ribosome binding site in its sequence, this 5' cap serves as the ribosome binding signal for the messenger RNA. So it is here that ribosomes initiate binding and then will translate this message into protein. The second modification, the second RNA processing step that is going to occur, is that polyadenylation will occur at the 3' end. We will play polyadenylase will post-transcriptionally modify the RNA by adding adenine-containing nucleotides to the 3' end. So we have 3' polyadenylation. And then the third key step is that we must splice introns out of the RNA. When these three steps are accomplished, we then have a mature mRNA, messenger RNA, that can be exported to the cytoplasm and then can be translated into protein. Translation will occur. Now, this third step brings out a very interesting point about eukaryotic genes, and that is that they are divided into exons and introns. Exon and introns. And the exons contain protein coding information. They all contain information that will be translated eventually into protein. So these contain protein coding information. But the introns of a gene do not contain coding information. And so in the pre-mRNA, what we have are exons that are present. We have exons that are present. And we have introns that are present. Introns, exons, introns, exons. And splicing occurs such that the introns are removed from the RNA. We'll talk about that, the mechanism of that shortly, such that we then produce an mRNA with a five prime cap, polyadenylation tail, poly A tail, and the exons of the gene are joined together now, are spliced together in the mRNA. So we are missing the information of the DNA that was present in introns. So introns are present in eukaryotic genes, but are spliced out. And also important to note is that we have in eukaryotes, as opposed to operons, we have monocistronic messenger RNAs. That is, every mRNA is going to be translated into one protein. So this will produce one protein, unlike the operons of prokaryotes. So let's look at these processes now in a little more detail. We've talked about the addition of a 5' cap, and that 5' cap is involved in translation initiation because the ribosome binds that 5' cap. And it also protects the RNA from degradation. The addition of that 3' poly A tail, which is generated by poly A polymerase, also protects the RNA from degradation. And the length of the poly A tail is correlated to the half-life of the messenger RNA in the cell. And that is an important regulatory step because the longer a half-life of an RNA in the cell, the more protein will be produced. So this is a potential point of regulation of gene expression. And then we have the splicing out of introns performed by a macromolecular assemblage that we call the spliceosome. And we'll talk about the components of the spliceosome shortly. So schematically speaking, we have the addition of a 7-methylguanosine to the 5' end of the mRNA, forming a 5' cap. And interestingly enough, this is added in reverse orientation, where the phosphates, we have a triphosphate that is joined to the phosphate of the first nucleotide of the messenger RNA. So this is joined in kind of a reverse direction compared to the normal polarity of the nucleotides in a messenger RNA, which go 5' to 3'. Here we have the guanosine cap as 5' here and 3' here. The 3' oxygen is the end of the 5' cap. And the three phosphates are joined directly to the 5' phosphate of the first nucleotide of the pre-mRNA. And here we have the poly A tail that is added downstream from a recognition site for the poly A polymerase. This is a recognition site found in eukaryotic mRNAs. It's a consensus sequence. Not all genes have this exact sequence, but it's a consensus sequence that is overall conserved. And the poly A polymerase recognizes this and begins synthesis of a poly A tail about 30 nucleotides downstream from this poly A hexamer, we call it, the poly A hexamer recognition site. And then we need to splice out the introns. So we've talked about what introns and exons are, and we've mentioned that small ribonucleoproteins recognize the intron-exon boundaries and conduct the splicing reactions that remove the introns from an RNA. And these small nuclear ribonucleoproteins are made out of small nuclear RNAs plus proteins. That's why it's called a ribonucleoprotein. And the RNAs are small nuclear RNAs, and these complex with proteins, and a given complex is called a SNRP, small nuclear ribonucleoproteins. And we will see that they interact to conduct the splicing reaction. And together, the various SNRNPs cluster with other proteins to form what we call the spliceosome that is actually catalyzes the removal of introns from eukaryotic pre-mRNAs. So here we have schematically a DNA template. Exons are shown in blue, introns in purple. We show a primary RNA transcript that has a poly-A tail added and a 5' cap. And then the splicing reaction removes the introns so that we have only exons present in the mature mRNA. And it is that which will be translated into protein when this mature mRNA is exported to the cytoplasm. And here are some of the types of experiments that led to the discovery of the split genes that we find in eukaryotes, with protein coding portions of a gene interrupted by non-protein coding portions of a gene, that is the introns. So when messenger RNA is hybridized back to DNA, the DNA is looped out because the introns are not complementary to the mature mRNA in a Watson-Crick base pair fashion. Only the exons found in the mature mRNA will anneal with the DNA, with the genomic DNA. And where introns are present in the DNA and can't hybridize to the mRNA, they are looped out as introns. And this is an electron micrograph. The discovery of these split genes in eukaryotes, unlike prokaryotes, was quite a surprise and raises several questions about the value of this type of gene architecture, because here's an extra step that needs to be introduced in order to produce a mature mRNA, the actual removal of introns from the RNA to produce a mature mRNA. We'll talk a little bit about that later. So let's look at the splicing in very general terms. Here's exon 1, and here's the exon 1 intron border right here. And then upstream of the exon 2 intron border, that is the 3' end of the intron, this is the 5' end of the intron, upstream of that 3' end of the intron, there is something we call the branch point, which has a conserved sequence in it, in which the RNAs of several SNRPs bind to, and there is a conserved branch point A that is very important in the splicing reaction. Now, these SNRPs, as we've mentioned, consist of RNA shown as a gold band here, and proteins shown as a kind of a yellow blob. And these RNAs not only interact with the, in a Watson-Crick hydrogen bonding fashion, with sequences at the 5' end of the intron and at the branch point, but they also interact with each other. And though that interaction brings together the 5' end of the intron and the 3' end of the intron, as we will see. So what we have here then is an association of the SNRPs at the branch point and at the 5' end of the intron. And then we have a covalent linkage through the 2' oxygen of this adenine with the first nucleotide of the intron at the 5' end. And that ends up forming a lariat structure. And then finally, the 3' exon is cleaved and remains as a free stretch. And after that, the 3' end of the first exon is joined to the 5' end of the second exon, and we have exon 1 joined to exon 2, and the lariat the intron forms a lariat, which is excised and removed catalyzed by the SNRPs, and we have then a mature mRNA, and the spliceosome disassembles. So as you can see, the biochemistry of this is rather complex, and it raises questions as to why eukaryotic genes are split into exons and introns. And I should mention parenthetically that introns can be sometimes very long sequences of DNA. That sometimes they're much larger, represent a greater proportion of the gene than do exons. So non-coding, non-protein coding information in DNA can represent the majority of sequences in a eukaryotic gene, which again is somewhat surprising. Now, the phenomenon of splicing raises a very interesting phenomenon, and that is the phenomenon of alternative splicing. And that what that alternative splicing allows for is that since about 35 to 60% of human genes can be alternatively spliced, or their RNAs produced by those genes can be alternatively spliced, it explains how the 25,000 genes of the human genome, approximately, can encode more than, many more than 25,000 proteins. So let's look at how alternative splicing might work. Here we have a gene shown with two introns and three exons. And in the first splicing pattern that occurs, we splice out both intron 1 and intron 2 so that we have exon 1, exon 2, and exon 3 joined together. Now, when that mRNA is translated, we will produce a protein that has amino acids that are specified by exon 1. That would be these amino acids. Amino acids specified by exon 2, that would be these purple amino acids. And amino acids specified by the aqua exon 3 here. And of course, this is one polypeptide chain that has been synthesized on a ribosome by translating mRNA-1 here into an amino acid sequence, a protein. But let's imagine that instead of splicing together the splice donor of intron 1 with the splice acceptor here, we block that splice acceptor. In that case, this splice donor will look for the next splice acceptor, which is down here. And there we would splice out not only intron 1, intron 2, but also exon 2 would be spliced out. And we would join together exon 1 with exon 3 into an alternative mRNA coming from this same gene, an alternative mRNA due to different RNA splicing patterns. And here, when that mRNA-2 would be translated into protein, we would only have amino acids in the final protein that correspond to the coding information of exon 1 and of exon 3. So we would have two different proteins produced from the same gene by alternative splicing. And there are many genes that will be spliced in one fashion, in one cell type, or at one time during development, but will be spliced in another tissue or another time in a different way. And in so doing, a given gene can specify more than one protein through this process of alternative splicing. So alternative splicing adds to the repertoire of proteins that can be produced from a given eukaryotic genome due to this alternative splicing. Now at this point, it will behoove us to consider the process of gene expression in both prokaryotes and in eukaryotes. And we will compare then gene expression in prokaryotes and eukaryotes by way of reviewing the processes that occur. So that's where we'll pick up within the next part of this lecture.